Well, hey guys, welcome back to the playground. Glad you stopped by. Real quick, I just want to thank everybody that subscribed to the channel, that stops by and watches the videos, leaves likes, comments, all that stuff. It really helps me want to do more and make more videos. Unfortunately, buy more stuff. My wife hates that part. I enjoy it still, but you know. Anyway, let's get into the video. So today, we have the Grasshopper 2 Black Edition. So I picked this up recently from an online retailer here in the States, Tower Hobbies. They've been having great sales all year long last couple months. But I got this like 20% off the normal price, so I couldn't pass it up. So I'm not going to do a whole unboxing video with it. I know by now pretty much anybody that's interested in Tamiya has probably seen one or 20, so I'm going to skip that. So we have, the servo to go in it, standard servo. I was thinking about putting the 540 Sport Tuned in it, and when I was shopping, I saw they had this 380 Sport Tuned motor. So this and the regular Grasshopper come with the standard silver can 380 motor. I have yet to see anybody put one of these in, so we're going to stick this guy in here and see how it performs versus the Grasshopper's silver can. So we're gonna check that out. That's probably gonna be the biggest new thing of this entire video. I bought this kit specifically because, I like keeping all of mine in reasonably nice shape. I don't like them scratched up and beat up and broken. Somewhat of a shelf queen guy now, but this one's gonna get some running. So I plan on beating this one up, scratching the body up. I'm not even gonna paint it. We're going to leave it black, and that way, if it does get beat up and scratched later on down the road, I can sand it down, kind of polish the plastic a little bit, repaint in a different color, and throw a whole different sticker set on there, maybe the original hopper set. I don't know. But the plan is right now, build it in kit form and beat the side out of it. All right, guys, let's get to the build. Alright guys, well, time lapse is up, car is built. Now obviously we still need to put the stickers on it and still need to get the driver dude painted and put him in, so I'll get that done this evening and tomorrow we'll be able to take this guy out for a spin. But until then, I want to go over a couple quick things in the instructions and a couple quick things about putting it together that may be able to help you out. Just little things that I picked up along the way. Overall, the kit is super, super easy to build, super quick, should take you an hour or so. Well, should take you a couple hours. If you could do it an hour, you're doing really good. Took me about an hour and a half, 2 hours maybe, to put the whole thing together. So let me hop out and go into the instruction manual and run you through a few things. All right, guys. So again, we've got it built. I just wanted to go over a few things in the instructions to show you some little tips and tricks, things to look out for, things to be careful for. So in this kit, you get your main Grasshopper 2 instructions. So basically, this is a recreation of the original instructions with some additional stuff for the speed controller. This is the updated one that includes this stuff with the Black Edition. So this has your oil-filled shocks in it and how to mount those up. Otherwise, pretty much same, same. I think this is all pretty much the same. It's just, the shocks and then mounting those up. So let's start at the beginning. So in the kit, we upgraded from these bearings or these plastic bushings to actual bearings. You can pick up a kit super cheap, probably about $8-10. I don't see any need to build a car anymore that doesn't have bearings. I mean, for $10, you have the peace of mind that everything is going to run smooth, and you know, you're not going to get that out of a bushing after you've run it for a little while. The bearing should still stay like that for quite a long time. Anyway, we replaced all the bushings for bearings and the transmission. Nothing really difficult here. Just, you know, make sure you get all the pins into place. When you actually go to put the transmission together, make sure that you remember to put that cross pin in, because that's what this rides on. It will actually all go together if you don't put that pin in, but you'll start getting some horrific noises out of the transmission once you start running it, because this whole gear is just kind of wallowing around. But it'll basically self-center itself and go in. It just will shorten its life tremendously. In this step, I realized something. We weren't able to put in the sport-tuned motor because the factory motor, this pinion is pressed onto the shaft. This has a larger shaft for a regular size pinion, and I don't have one that size. So we had to assemble it with a silver can, so no big deal, but we will put this in here later. Another tip on here, these little screws are very small, very soft, and have flatheads. So make sure you find a flathead screwdriver that fits those slots very well, so you don't cam those out and screw those up. Don't forget your little nuts that have to get pressed on into the back. And that's not really the only trickiness on that. So one of the things that may be frustrating to new builders or just anybody in general, this whole assembly kind of has to go all together at one time. I suggest you put your spring on as it shows in the steps above. You have a left and a right, so put your springs on. Really, all these things are doing is just kind of holding in that little slot and just kind of sitting there, so they pop off real easy. My suggestion is to go ahead and mount this side, or this side, doesn't matter. Mount one side to the chassis. You don't have to put it all the way on, just get it on there so you can't actually push it off. I would go ahead and snug it up just to ensure that that spring can't pop off in any manner. That way you don't have to worry about this spring, you don't have to worry about this mount, you don't have to worry about accidentally pushing it off as you're trying to get everything lined up. Once you have this one mounted, then you can kind of slide this in, make sure that it's on top of that spring. And then this side, what I recommend you do is when you're grabbing this piece, pull this spring down and kind of pinch it to the top of the piece here. Well, technically the bottom as you're looking at it, but it's actually the top. Make sure the spring stays on everything, pinch that down, and then work this in to capture this side of the rod and press it on. That way, this little spring wants to pop off so easily because there's really nothing holding it on. Once it's captured, you can let go of that little spring. It's not going anywhere, and put your screws in, and then just make sure, double check to make sure your springs are correct, and you know, you don't have a spring on top of the axle and then below the axle kind of thing. That's the only tricky part, I believe, where you can kind of get messed up. Once you get past here, you go into the old shocks in this book. You want to switch over to the additional pamphlet or additional instruction book and start working on these. Shocks go together super, super simple. I recommend you just oil up these, get everything ready and have all your shocks ready to go. Have all your pieces cut, have all your parts ready. That way you can just assembly line the shocks. You're not doing one after another. But basically I oil up all the little O-rings first, and then have all my shocks standing up. Put your O-rings into the shocks. So basically just press one in and then get the oily one, stick it on your finger, press the other one in. And then go ahead and put that shock cap, the lower cap on. What I do is I tighten it all the way down and then I loosen it up one and a half turns. And what that does is it fully seats these, but it backs it off so they're a little bit loose in here. You don't want them under pressure because you don't want them squished so they're spreading out. Because they'll spread out this way, but they'll also spread out internally, which you want that when the shaft is in there. But before that shaft is in there, you want the center of the O-ring as loose as possible, and you want that lubrication in there. So when you put that shaft, oh my God, that sounded horrible. So you want these oiled up. So when you put the actual shock shaft, because it's threaded on the end, you want that to not dig into those O-rings and scar up those O-rings. So you want those oiled. They don't have to be like drippy wet. You don't have to be shock oil oozing down the shock or anything. Just lubed up is all you need. So many innuendos with this. But put your shock shaft through. And then once your shock shaft is through, go ahead and tighten that bottom cap up all the way. That'll give you a nice firm seal with those two O-rings. And the shock shaft won't slide around on you quite as much. Then on the bottom ones, make sure that you put the spacer on before you put the bottom. Thread your bottoms on and then you're ready to fill. Filling super easy, standard, pull it all the way down, fill up your oil, give it a few seconds, slowly push it to the top, and then slowly pull it back down. You should get a few good air bubbles when you do that. Give it a few seconds, slowly push it back up. You'll see little tiny air bubbles kind of get pushed up. Let them pop and then pull it back down. Once you do that, you basically want to fill it up like 99% full and then put your little seal caps on. There's different seal caps for the front and the rear. The front are the greens and the rear are the reds. You basically want to stick that on and just press it down. It'll kind of make a nice seat. You want a little bit of oil to seep out when you do that. If you have oil seeping out, then you filled up the shock enough. If you didn't have oil seeping out, pull the cap back up, pull the seal back off, put a few more drops in, and stick it back on. As soon as you have oil coming out, just wipe that off with a paper towel carefully, and then thread your top cap on. Go ahead and you can make sure the top and the bottom are nice and tight, and then cycle the shock. You shouldn't hear a whole lot of like squidgy noise in there. You may hear a little bit, some teeny tiny air bubbles, but you want a nice clean sound. This shock oil that they give you, it's their soft shock oil. It's thick. I don't know if it's the springs or the oil or a combination of both. But yeah, it's thick. But anyway, so then you put your springs on. So notice in the front that the springs, when you put them on, have a teeny tiny bit of play. Basically, when you put them on the car and the car loads up, that play is gone. So the fronts are fine. The backs had quite a bit of play. So I did put one of the heaviest spacers, the little collar around the top of it. And that has taken up all the play when it's sitting there. Let me take the body off. So yeah, you can see the little shock spacer I put on top. Because like right now, it is just coming up to that spacer. And if I took the weight off of it with the car, it would actually have a gap between the spring and the cap if that spacer wasn't there. But yeah, the rears seem like really, really, really slow. Front seem to be okay. The rear just seems really, really slow. So I might end up taking the oil out of this and putting about a half as thick of an oil in the rear. Because the problem with these things is they just bounce around so much in the rear anyway. I might lighten up that fluid to try to help that out a little bit, but we'll see when we run it, what it looks like. All right, back to instructions. So once you get the shocks on, basically you have to put on, you just have to mount the front suspension and front bumper. In the original book, don't go by those instructions. They have new instructions in here on how to mount the shocks. It is way different than in here. Mounting the tires and wheels, same. Battery door, you want to make sure that those pins, when you put them on, that those holes are going side to side in the nubs, because these here have to go left and right when you're putting them in. The only other way to do it would be front and back, and you're not going to get the clip to go all the way on here. Even if you did, you run the risk of, as you're driving, something coming up and catching that little clip and pulling it out. Next thing you know, your door flops off and you're dragging your battery around, having a bad day. So another thing with these is, I forgot to mention, like I said, it shows in here making sure that they're side to side. It doesn't specifically say it, but you do need to make sure that the holes are going side to side. The problem that I had, which was a minor problem, but just so you're aware, you know, I bought JIS screwdrivers specifically for building the Tamiya kits. So a number 2 JIS is your common one, and it fits 90% of all the screws. The number 1 fits a lot of the smaller screws. The problem is, these are number 2 screws, but the holes are just too small to get the head of that screwdriver down in there. So I actually had to use the number one, which does not work very well on the number two screws. It wants to cam out as well, just like a regular Phillips head would. So you may have to go digging through your drawer of Phillips screwdrivers to find one that fits in the hole and grabs hold of the head of the screw fairly well. So just be careful when you're putting these in. They're kind of a tight fit, so you do have to kind of crank on them to get them drawn up tight so they're not rattling around. But yeah, that's about all I got for you. Everything else is really, really simple. Like I said, it's an overall simple kit. But we will get this guy out tomorrow. I've got to go in and get the body washed off, get the stickers on it, get the driver dude painted up, get him installed, and then we'll be ready to run it around and see how it does on the stock motor. And then hopefully I can get the pinion to put the sport tuned 380 in there and we can see how that does. All right, I'll come back and show you once we have kind of all stickered up and ready to run before I take it out for a run, because I'd rather show it to you before it gets all torn up. Guys, we took it out for a drive. This was bone stock, and the determination is bone stock sucks. It is slow. This reminded me of, you know, the old school Radio Shack and Toys R Us type stuff when I was growing up. Grass wasn't that long. It surely lived up to the name Hopper. The back end is just bouncing all over the place. For that very brief drive, maybe 7 or 8 minutes, this little tiny motor is pretty warm. Speed controller is, you know, room temperature still. So I have ordered the pinion for this, and I also have ordered the pinion for this. So we're going to do the 380 sport first, and then the 540 sport after that. The biggest problem I see with the 540 is just hitting the rear suspension, so I have to figure that out. But I'm hoping this peps it up to where it's fun enough to drive. Right now, it's fun-ish. It's slow. So, you know, for me to have fun driving it, I think it's going to need at least this to pep it up. But regardless, it's been a fairly long video. I hope anybody that is looking to buy this kit isn't turned off by the slowness. You can obviously make it faster. It is a good kit to start with, the Grasshopper or the Grasshopper 2. If you like a little bit more futuristic styling, go with the Grasshopper 2. The original Grasshopper, you know, very, very classic. This does have the oil-filled shocks. I think it is kind of pointless in the rear because I really, driving it, I didn't see the rear shocks doing anything. It was basically the rear end pivoting is most of the suspension. Otherwise, it was just bouncing up and down. Front shocks do work for it. Before I ran it, I did take the stock fluid out of the rear. I'm assuming the stock fluid is somewhere around a 35-ish weight. It's either like a 30 or a 40. But I put in some Losi 20 weight, and it's still hard as a rock. So I don't think there's much helping the rear. Front seems to be fine out of the box. You're good to go there. But again, it's a great one to add to the collection. We're going to throw the different motors in it in future videos and see how they work. And we'll go from there. But for now, that's it for this video. Hope you guys liked it. Hope you guys learned a little something from it. Throw me a like. Drop me a comment. But anyway, everybody out there, be happy, be healthy, be safe. Catch you next time.